17. All right. 42. So, hut. Yeah. So, hey, it's the week after the thing that I can't say because of copyright and the National No Fun League, I guess. There was an owl, and it was superb, and that happened last week.
Yeah, it was a Christmas owl.
It was a superb owl, if you will. But it is now the weekend after the superb owl, and we're back playing Dungeons & Dragons. So it's been a minute since last time we played.
Oh shit, fuck, I spilled some. I'll be right back.
Of course you
And it will continue to be more minutes until we properly get back into playing. As Phil attempts to salvage his computer and whatever else, he just spilled everything all over. But yeah. So, I don't know. I mean, we kind of went through a recap before, but... let's see. So, you guys have a dead friend. Specifically, Taylor has a dead player character that you guys are trying to resurrect. And you followed stories and hints and legendary things in pursuit of Father Kios, an apparently long gone holy man who actually had the power to cast a powerful enough resurrection spell to bring Togar back. One of probably a handful that have walked the earth in recent memory. All of this led you to the Feywild. And after making that journey, you walked for a bit, ran into a weird little, like, earth-walking, long-haired, satyr-y thing that we've come to call Rock Sounds, because that's what his voice sounds like. And eventually you found a little hut at the edge of a cliff, inside of which dwelt the object of your search, Father Kios. And as it turns out, he's already in the midst of bringing back someone who is near and dear to, a stranger, because I don't think you're ever actually introduced, but there's an Eladrin that has kind of come and gone a few times over the days. certainly not a pleasant individual, but Father Kios is attempting to help this individual all the same. You were told to wait 3 days, kind of reflect on Togar and his life and the weighty decision that it is to bring someone back from the dead, especially in such a context that would require this world-shattering level of magic. And we'll say that you guys are kind of like, let's see, I think we left off basically end of the first day, beginning of the second day. But really, it's more of the same. So, on this second day, maybe partway through, the Eladrin that you had seen before, this kind of elven looking individual who the first day had brought with them like a wave of ice and snow, and basically anywhere they walked the temperature dropped by like a good 40 degrees, they return, or at least you think it's them, because this time when they come back you can see that instead of bringing a wave of frozen like ice and snow and just a wintry blast across their wake. They radiate heat. There are bits of their like hair and even some of their clothing that just seems to crackle with this like low burning flame. And this time,
wait, is he like actually on fire?
Yeah.
Do I see him?
Yeah.
I want to light a blunt on him.
Okay. Okay, so we have this scene where this Eladrin like kind of storms purposefully toward the hut and like bangs on the door demanding to see Father Kios, who like opens the door. And I don't know, I mean, Bungo very well could still be out like finding more stuff to smoke, so maybe he like comes back and sees this conversation going on as Kios is inside in the doorway and this just like smoldering Eladrin is standing outside just talking down to Father Kios, like just impatient and like snappy and just being a huge dick, especially to somebody who's going to bring back somebody that you care about. And so, you know, things, you can see things are getting heated, no pun intended.
Can I have done something too?
Sure. What do you want to have done?
That. As he's yelling and screaming, I just cast that from inside.
Calm emotions.
Yeah. I just look over at him and I say, would you just calm yourself for about 5 minutes?
Your tits, make them be calm.
Okay. Let's see how that whole saving throw thing works out for them. If the character sheet will load, that is. Here we go.
No character sheet for you?
No.
9999!
Same.
Okay. Damn it, Phil. It's a 9.
That would be a no. He is just calm as he can be for a minute.
Calm as tits.
Okay. So, yeah, you kind of watch as, like, mid-rant, the spell kind of takes effect. And this like visual embodiment of anger and wrath just kind of like pauses and deep breath, sigh, calms down and begins to speak in a pretty level tone. though still, I guess, more politely expressing concern that, you know, he would like to see this person brought back. And so I guess at this point, as the berating and yelling has kind of simmered down for the time being, this would be, I guess, when Bungo is like close enough to be able to interact. So, yeah, you just want to walk up and, like, mid-conversation.
Don't mind me!
Okay, yeah, so Bungo just, like, walks up and just holds the very tip of, you know, nice little black grass, yeah. And yeah, it works. It's fire. So, yeah, that's a thing.
Pretty lit.
And, so probably, like, I don't know, as you're standing there smoking, the effect wears off pretty soon. So, as the conversation kind of goes on, the Eladrin's voice kind of, like, raises a little more. Gets kind of back up to that just furious point that they were at before, and seeing that he's not really making any inroads with Father Keos, he just turns around and like begins to storm off and probably like almost runs into Bungo. And then just kind of staring down at Bungo with this look of, I'm not dealing with this right now. You watch as his being just kind of like folds together and disappears, reappearing with a blast of flame like 30 feet away, and he just storms off into the woods.
I want to know how to do that. Out of character, what spell is that?
Probably Misty
Step. That's not a spell.
What is it?
Oh, it's racial.
Yeah, it's a racial thing.
So. Can I, like, change my race?
I mean, Misty Step does the same thing.
If I druid form into that race, can I do that?
If only you had a way to turn into a medium fey.
I've seen one.
Uh-huh, but they're not beasts.
I mean, he could with true polymorph, but...
Yes. It's true.
God, I love this game.
But, he didn't answer your question.
Wait, what?
Will he be able to cast all the spells of a medium fey?
Yeah.
True polymorphs?
Yes.
With true polymorph, you become the thing.
Become the thing? For how long?
Well, you can choose to just remain the thing.
Forever, if you want.
But I can also choose to be it, do some fiery stuff, and then change back.
I think it's for an hour.
Yes!
So now you just have to get to... Is that, what, a level 9 spell?
Yeah, I think it's level 17? 18? Something like that?
Got a ways to go.
Yeah.
Basically...
Dragon and kill it, that'll be enough XP.
Suddenly, an ancient white dragon appears, the same one that we had threatened to be used against the PCs on Wednesday, because that's just what I do now.
I cast Wish, I wish it dead.
Dragons. Right.
Your wish fails.
It wishes that you are dead, and then you are dead.
Too late, already dead.
Alright, so, that happens. And again, you know, it's mostly sitting around, meditating. You know, Keos every once in a while goes out and, makes some sort of holy sign over the presumed sarcophagus or whatever this thing is that kind of overlooks the cliffside. And so the next day passes. Third day comes around, and the Eladrin shows up again, still in this like fiery form, and this time it just stands out there and waits and stares intensely at the hut of Father Keos as the last day kind of winds down. And again, Keos comes out now and then doing some sort of sign some sort of holy rite over this thing. And every time the Eladrin walks over, hoping that this will be the one. So it goes for the rest of the day. Until what you assume would be dusk. The thing about days in the Feywild is they're all kind of samey. Like, when I say it's been 2 days, it's been like two sleep cycles for you. Well, two cycles of, you know, getting up, staying up all day, or what you think is a day, and then sleeping, because The sun never really finishes rising or setting. It's always just kind of at the horizon, leaving these weird pastel kind of hues across the sky. And so at what you guess is about the end of a third day, Father Kios comes out, and you can see that this time he has some more, I guess, obvious remnants of his proper priestly attire. he has a certain colored piece of cloth kind of hung over his neck, draped down both sides of his body, like over his normal robes. He has a small pendant that you haven't seen before, but has it kind of around his neck, but he's holding it up in front of him. And there's like a dull kind of palish white glow that emanates from it. And the whole time as he comes walking out of the hut, he is uttering what seems like the incantation for such a spell that might just be capable of, well, bringing something back from so far beyond the grave that most mortal creatures couldn't even conceive of it. And so he finishes his approach to the altar or tombstone or whatever this large hunk of rock is that overlooks the cliffside. And at this point he takes the amulet off from around his neck, still kind of glowing. He sets it on the stone. You see him kind of trace out in the air in front of him the same signs that he's been tracing for the last 3 days. But this time, his finger seems to leave an actual trace in the air, and you can see this like glowing silver light just seeming to come from nowhere, hovering there in front of him. He reaches into his robes and with both hands pulls out, like with his hands kind of cupped, he pulls something out, raises it over his head and over the inscription that he's made, and you watch as he sprinkles these tiny gleaming gemstones, a number of tiny diamonds that just flow down like droplets of water and pass through the inscription in the air. And as they filter through, they take on some of the glowing aspect of the rune that's hovering there in front of him. And just as they reach a point where they would hit the top of the stone, they seem to impact and then disperse like droplets of water, almost evaporating in the process. Leaving kind of a fine mist lingering over the top of the stone slab. The mist then begins to kind of swirl and form itself into a humanoid shape. This like silvery, almost like a, like the roughest version of a character model that you could think of, kind of just integrating itself out of nothing, lying on its back on the stone slab. And then you watch as little by little the finer details of this person begin to emerge. And as this happens, you see the the Eladrin, who's been kind of overseeing all of this, just come up, and he's watching intently, obviously. But at this point, it's a visible conflict between wanting to just jump in right now and cradle whoever this person was that they lost, but at the same time, not wanting to do anything that could interfere with the spell. But you watch as a vibrant, almost green in color, elven humanoid form begins to take full shape on the stone. The long, dagger-like pointy ears, hair that almost kind of resembles like just the most recently grown, like, green like buds off of a tree or bush, clothed in attire that looks to be made almost entirely of vibrant green and almost pinkish leaves. You see the person that this Eladrin has been waiting for. And they're just lying there on their back, now apparently complete, but still unresponsive. And the last little remnants of the swirling smoke and mist around, they kind of creep up the form and kind of just flow into the just slightly open lips of this person before there's a dramatic and they just come to wide awake, like with a jolt. They like sit up, look around, they lay eyes on the angry Eladrin that you've seen.
Is he still angry?
He's intense. The fire that like burns on and around his person is visibly less than it was in the time leading up to all this. And while it almost seems like it goes entirely against this this being's existence, at least in the form that it's currently in, you do see just the slightest hint of kind of a softening of the features and the gaze as they see this this person return to them. And there's kind of like a moment of, is that really you? Just an unspoken kind of glance between the two before the one who's just brought back kind of like hops off the platform and like runs over and almost like jumps into the flaming one's arms. Massive, like just full body hug, almost tackling down to the ground. And so you see this reunion happen. And Kios just kind of stands by, taking it in. And after after the hug and reunion in that aspect is done, the formerly fiery Eladrin just sort of turns around. Again, kind of an intensity to the gaze, but tempered. He just says, thank you. And without another word, the two of them just disappear. You see the flaming one, and the same thing that Bungo was so envious of, a swirl of flame and just almost like folding in on itself before just disappearing. And the other one just disappears in a poof of fluttering leaves.
Damn.
Then Kios turns to you guys. He says, "So, I think it's almost time for us to bring back your lost friend. He just shoots a gaze back in the direction that the two Eladrin had disappeared in. And he says, "You've seen over these last 3 days what can happen to people who are affected by loss, who allow it to control them. There were times, if you were not here, as illogical as it would be for him to do anything, I might have feared for my life. Loss can ruin someone. In this case, I have preyed on it, and my God seems to tell me that what you say is true. That this Togar has things yet to do. But this won't always be the case. And the next time this happens, whether it's Togar, or whether it's one of you, or a friend of yours that you've not even come to know yet, you will need to be able to live with the fact that sometimes what's gone stays gone. Kind of looks around, not really saying anything else, just attempting to drive the point home.
Carmilla just kind of nods solemnly.
And
Bungo just kind of has a blank look.
Okay. And so then he turns around and begins to kind of clean up what little signs of disturbance there are on the stone slab. he returns for a moment into the hut, and you hear him kind of rummaging through some things. He comes back out and stands at the door and says, "Takes a lot out of me. But it's time."
I'm going to cast Bless on him.
Okay.
I know it's not much, but I'll walk over and I will say, "Father, I thank you for everything that you've done and for dealing with people like, well," and I'll kind of point in the direction that the guy disappeared from, and I'll say, "You know, it's not much, but may my God bless you as well," and I'll reach out and touch him and cast Bless.
Okay. All right. And, he nods and thank you, Tormilla. would you do me the honor of assisting in this ritual?
Of course.
He reaches into his robes and hands you like a sizable kind of scoop of, again, these like tiny minuscule diamonds. It says, when it comes time, I'd like you to assist in applying these. You saw how the process went.
Yes. I would be honored to assist you in this.
It seems you and Togar have some connection, whether you're aware of it or not. I'm not sure. But seems important that I let you do this. And so he kind of straightens out, fixes the cloth that's draped over his neck, takes his amulet up in one hand once again, and begins uttering the same magic words. And while I don't think we need to go into the same fine level of detail all over again, you do watch as he proceeds to the slab, traces the rune in the air, and upon finishing the incantation, Kios and Tormilla take handfuls of these tiny diamonds and sprinkle them down through the hovering rune. As they fall, they disperse, and a considerably shorter, stockier humanoid form begins to appear, comprised of this mist. And little by little, you do watch as Togar reforms in front of all of you. And the last little swirling bit of mist filters in through his mouth and nose, and he awakens with a start.
So,
end of episode.
Yeah, that was a good, 40 minutes of D&D.
Yeah.
My parents said 9:30.
9:30, okay. So yeah, Togar, you're awake.
Yes, so very first thing Togar does is wakes up and kind of like jumps up and is like just ready for the fight. And he's looking around and just sees Forrest, sees Bungdo, Maya, and Tormilla, and then sees an old elf. And looks at Bungdo first, and then kind of shakes his head, looks at Maya, and says, "What happened? Where am I?" "Where are we?"
I offer him a joint, because he's going to need it. Just like shaking my head, I walk up to him like... "Welcome back, buddy."
Back from where? The last thing I knew, we were in a... Oh. But didn't I...
Yep.
And at this point, I look over towards Tormilla and kind of say, "Was this your doing? Or was this..."
"No more than your other two friends here. We went on quite the journey together."
"It's been 23 years!
What?
Yeah, we had to go level up to get Wish.
he may be exaggerating a little bit.
We had to go get more powerful.
It's probably been closer to 23 days than 23 years. But it's been a while. And, you look good.
What happened to... Where'd Lilith go? Is she hiding in the shadows somewhere? Where is she?
I just make a over at the other two.
I make a poof motion with my hands.
She didn't make it.
You guys did though? How did you get out?
Lilith's god kind of stepped in. She gave Lilith enough power for one last kind of thing, and yeah. Destroyed them all.
Oh. Well. I'm kind of torn. It's nice to be back in the world of the living, but is it right?
Kios kind of chimes in and says, in many cases, the answer to such a question would be no. But your friends seem to believe, and my deity corroborates, that you still have a difference to make.
Me? I'm just a blacksmith. And at this point, I kind of look over at Tormilla, and I say, is this true? Am I destined for something? Something I don't even know?
Could I be the chosen one? She says, well, I did have something to discuss with you when I ended up in Drake's Landing, waiting to see you all upon your return from Helmfirth. But let's ease into that. You've had an interesting month.
Yeah, to say the least. I'll have to let you guys know as to what I experienced, too. It's wild. And I'll kind of hop down off the, slab, and I'll look around and I'll say, well, does anybody have a drink? I could really go for some booze right now.
Let's see. I mean, I feel like Tormilla probably has a couple of flasks of something on her.
Yeah,
that's a Tormilla thing to do. So yeah, she'll
dwarven
pull
holy
one.
Water.
More like dwarven fire water, but
I mean, we have an alchemy jug and a mini keg.
There you go.
So.
Yeah, so from somewhere you guys have booze.
All
right.
So, I'll drink a whole big mug of
a whole booze.
One
whole
booze. How many marijuanas
booze,
would you like to smoke?
All of them.
In the Feywild, that's a fucking lot.
Bungo is up to the challenge. Bungo. 4,220.
Yeah. So, okay. One booze later.
Yeah.
We'll say that you guys are caught up to the point that, you know, we don't need to spend a ton of a ton more in character time telling a player who was here for the whole thing what happened.
I think we do. He may have missed something while he was dead.
Yeah. So, okay. You guys catch up, and I mean, I think at least when you've once you've had some sort of chance to kind of calm down and reacclimate to being in, well, maybe not the land of the living so much, but being at least among the living.
Yeah.
I think Tormilla, probably having indulged a bit herself, says, "All right, so I know I said it could wait, but I she like pauses and says, "I was sent from Thogladar. Well, where to begin? So, you remember, obviously, all that business with Farrag Leadforge and his basement and all that craziness. As I'm sure you're aware, he was a rather prominent part of the trade ministry. And, well, after having such a conspiracy going on right under his nose, Father is, suffice to say, concerned about having it happen again. We know that you're a member in good standing of at least one of the major trade guilds, and he was wondering, is there any chance of you coming back and taking a job with the ministry? It's a lot, I know.
For the second time, you see Togar just kind of pale as a sheet. All this information just dropped at once. I feel like it would at least be good to go back to Thogladar. See my parents. Oh, and I look over to Tormilla. What do they know of this?
They don't know. I made sure.
Good. We need to keep it that way. And I'll look to Bungdo and to Maya, too. Extremely serious look on my face. They cannot know about this.
Bungdo just has a shit-eating grin.
They lost one son, my brother. I'm not gonna let them worry about losing me.
I mean, to be fair, they already lost you.
Yeah,
they don't have to worry about it.
They just don't know it.
But what they don't know won't hurt them any more than, the loss already has for them.
Until suddenly, the land of Astian is afflicted by a terrible death curse. Oh wait, that's a different campaign.
Half of the people die!
So, I'll look to Maya and Bungdo and say, well, what are your plans after this? Are you guys heading off?
Well,
somewhere?
Honestly, I didn't think we'd get this far, so I'm pretty open.
I don't really have any plans.
Well, whatever happened with the investigation Blackwell sent us on? Did you guys find the source of whatever was causing that?
I mean, I'm pretty sure that was...
Okay.
Yeah, so
that would be a thing that you kind of get caught up on. Does Taylor out of character remember?
Bits and pieces.
Okay. So...
I didn't think that we had fully finished everything.
I mean, upon seeing what everything turned out to be, it all kind of added up. Like, you know, stepping out of full immersion storytelling mode for a second. The slime in the basement thing is Aboleth 101.
Oh.
And everything else could basically be explained through the combination of the Aboleth, but then also the fact that the Aboleth was not really entirely its own, or under its own control, because it had the intellect devourer in it, and so the like trio of mind flayer mages were kind of like the puppet masters in the whole thing.
I forgot about that. Okay. I thought we still had an Aboleth to deal with.
Nope.
Okay.
We are Aboleth free.
So I'll say, well, I guess if you guys want, we can go back. We can all go back to Thogladar. See what's going on there, and I'll look at Tormella. I can talk with your father and see what we can arrange.
Yeah, she nods and says, "All right, sounds like a plan." She like turns and goes over to Father Kios and again like kind of like takes him by the hands and just, you know, bows and says, "Thank you," and yeah, kind of steps off. And the whole time, by the way, Seema has just been standing by smoking a fucking shitload of black grass.
I want to talk to the father and ask him if he's planning on staying here or wants to go back. Or...
He says that he's kind of grown to like it here. And to be honest, the organized church is not the best representation of Eldath and his will at all times. So he's kind of at peace with his place being here now.
Should we tell them something when we go back?
He thinks on it and says, I suppose, but tell only the foremost authority, the highest ranking priest in the temple. I don't want everyone from across the continent coming to the tree and then eventually to the Feywild and just waltzing into their, well, almost assured demise.
Mm-hmm.
You all got attacked on your way in here. It'd be horrific to imagine some civilian coming here.
Yeah. Okay.
At this point, I'll walk up to Father Kios and extend my hand and say, thank you, first and foremost. Togar Hammerstriker.
He nods and says, Father Kios, pleasure to meet you.
And you as well. I know we just met, but... You've done me a great service. And I will say that I will not die again. Not like that. But I also won't squander the gift that has been given. I am a religious man myself, and, well, dwarf myself, but, and I know a blessing such as this is not one to be taken, like, lightly. So.
He nods and says, "Well, then live a life of appreciation to your friends and your God, and I'm sure whatever purpose is yet in store for you, you will find and you will achieve."
I will, and I will do my best to aid and protect my friends as well as anybody in need.
And again, he nods and, like, makes a quick, like, holy sign over you. Says, "Good. Now go and live it."
Alright. I'll give him a short bow and, turn to Maya and I'll say, "So did any of my stuff survive?" I don't actually have a character sheet, so.
There is that.
Well, everything in the bag of holding survived.
Yeah. Well, I think my gun and stuff survived because that was magical.
Yeah.
So. We can kind of hand wave Maya giving me all my stuff back.
Mm-hmm.
I would assume Maya had it, because I don't think Bunda would have it.
Probably not.
Okay. Yeah, you have your character sheet now, though, right?
Checking. Yes.
Okay.
Alright, so, I will strap on my ammo pouch and the gun, and that's about all I had. Everything else is gone. I'll kind of look around and say, "So, how do we get out of here?"
You look around cluelessly, and I think... Tormilla, being an expedient plot device, says, "We had some help getting here. And so I suppose we'll have to either message our ride, or I did hear something about just finding crossings out in the Feywild somewhere."
"Well, how dangerous is it out here?"
At this point, you like look around warily, right? And
yeah,
do Seema, you know, big cloud of black grass smoke hovering around her, and standing like off to one side. As you just asked, "How dangerous is it around here?" You see rock sounds, the little like dreadlocked rock gnome satyr thing, like wave at you with a couple of his dreads.
Oh, that's rock noises, by the way.
Okay. And I'll just kind of lean in and go, "What the hell is he?" I don't know if that picked up.
Yeah, it did.
Yeah. A fey creature.
He's a Korrid. lady is concerned.
I'll kind of look to Tramilla. Well, we can wander, but I don't know how important it is for us to get back quickly.
All right, 1 second. Let me do some conflict resolution here. Pete stole Sadie's bed.
Pete's what?
Pete stole Sadie's bed.
Pete.
Off.
And she is just whining.
Here you go, Sadie.
That's a good play.
Sadie.
She just doesn't want him on this bed. She doesn't want her bed. She just doesn't want him on her bed.
Wow.
Here, Sadie. Sadie. Pete, no.
He's like, all right, I'll lay on it.
Pete, come. That's a good boy.
Yeah, Sadie, you over here. There you go.
Okay, I think we're good. So, that was all fun. All right, so let's see. We had somebody who had the ability, I think, to message Blackwell.
Tarmilla did.
Okay, that's what I thought.
Yeah, she's got sending.
Okay. Yeah. So then... I think she kind of like looks at the group and says, well, if we're all ready, I can I can reach out to our, and she like hesitates, friend. And I assume she hears nothing, no protest from anybody, and so
nope.
Yeah. Alright. Cool. And so you see her, like, kind of pause and concentrate for a moment. And, she says, alright. We just need to make it back to where we entered this place. So that's maybe about a day's travel. This way, and she like points away from the cliffside and all that stuff, kind of back deeper into the woods.
You hear the sound of a gun being cocked. All right, let's go.
All right. And so we fade out of this scene with the party just heading back out into the forest. And again, I think this is one of those things we can kind of hand wave. I'm not going to like roll a random encounter or whatever and just make you fight for no reason. So, yeah, you spend about a day traveling through the woods, and eventually, at least as far as those of you who were a part of the entry expedition, you reach a point that you're pretty confident is the area where you teleported in. You like look around, and for a second it like takes you a minute to verify, because things do kind of run together here, but eventually you do find the circle of various like oddly shaped and colored mushrooms that served as the teleportation circle on the way in. And so yeah, you see Tormilla again, like pause, concentrate, send a message, and she says, all right, it'll be just a couple of minutes. And within a couple of minutes, your old friend in air quotes, Blackwell shows up, and upon seeing you all and noticing that Togar is once again among your number, he says, "Ah, Mr. Hammerstriker, good to see you again."
And you as well.
seems the journey was a success. I'm happy to hear of this. And I will also be happy to return home. So, if you don't mind, he like gestures you all inside the circle of mushrooms.
Do I see any black grass near us within plain sight?
Sure.
I run over and grab a handful.
Okay, just run over and and then they go. Okay.
Like, I pulled up the plant with, like, soil under it. Just one plant. And I'm carrying it.
Alright.
You know, I'm gonna use Mage Hand just to grab a top.
Okay.
And just bring it back over to myself.
Alright.
As we're getting into the mushroom circle, I just kind of look up at Blackwell and say, I don't suppose you have a pot!
He says, I'm sure you'll manage.
Well, I'd manage better with a pot!
He's already in the middle of, like, casting the spell.
I hand you my crate with a box. I don't know what's in it, but...
The box in a box?
Yeah, it was a box in a box.
It is five...
Sunbox.
I think that might have been the box that the, Beholder Eye necklace thing came in.
Yes.
Oh, just put it on top of that.
Yeah.
But yeah, so anyway, Blackwell casts a spell, and you guys watch as by now, you know, it's pretty familiar, you watch reality kind of begin to fade away, bright flash of light, falling sensation, and poof, suddenly you are back in the, like the Hall of Magical Achievement in Balinor. And... So from this point, I mean, I guess we have some questions to answer, right? Like, was there anything that you guys wanted to do that didn't involve going back to Thogladar? Or, I mean, I guess, do you still have any business here would be the first question.
I don't. I just need to get back to Thogladar.
Mm-hmm.
I have no business.
None whatsoever.
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay. Alright. Well, if there are no protests, I suppose we can kind of montage it. So you guys spend several days traveling back west through the woods, passing by, you know, a few little encampments of refugees and all of that, people displaced by the ongoing civil war here in the Elven Realms of Unarith. You continue on, passing, like, you know, the occasional like collapsed and picked over cart. It seems that basically none of any of the stuff that's been left behind is of any use. And eventually you...
Oh, do we leave? What's her name?
Seema?
Yeah.
Yeah, she would probably hang back.
Okay.
Yeah. And so you guys make it all the way back through the gates of Fort Eladon and back into the kingdom of Akrant, where it's only a couple days' travel before Tormilla and Togar are once again home sweet home in Thogladar. So, I guess we'll pick this up as you guys have, like, just entered the city. So what's the first course of action? Are we doing the, hey, Mom and Dad, just wanted to come and say hi and definitely not tell you about how I died? Or are we talking business?
Well, I am going to suggest that I guess I'll do it in character. Bungo and Maya, maybe we should have you guys stay at either at the... Well, and I'll look at Tormilla. What was this you were saying about taking over that spot? So would I take over the house as well?
She says, well, it's not inherently part of the office, but it's, well, there haven't been many takers on the Zombie Beholder house. So I'm sure it's still on the market.
I'll look to them and say, well, if you guys want to stay there instead of staying with my parents, I'll try to work something out with the boss, and I'll kind of smile, you know, throw a sidelong smile at Tormilla. And then
Bungo rolls his eyes.
And then you guys, if you guys have anything you want to do, I can meet up with you guys later.
Sure.
And then I can at least let you guys know what the plan is from there.
Is it okay if we stay in a random house?
Tormilla says, I mean, we can talk to my father, but I... Like I said, I don't imagine that they have many other uses, so at least while it remains unspoken for, could serve as a decent temporary place.
Okay.
So, I will say I had the random key kind of tucked into my gun because I wasn't sure what it was for. I'll pull it out and give it to Bungo, and I'll say, here, Bungo, see if you can find what this key is used for.
Oh, fuck yeah, treasure hunt!
I pulled it from that house, so see if you can figure it out.
And Bungo's eyes just go wide as a fucking moon.
Out of character, I know exactly what the fuck that's used for.
What does it go to?
It is the key to a box of dildos, I believe.
I mean, to be toys. More accurately, it's just a big box of kinky shit, yeah.
So, but I figure it's something to keep Bungo busy for.
Oh, more than a bit.
And I'll just kind of look at my aunt and say, try to keep him out of trouble.
You're literally consigning her to this doom.
I'm not sure how capable I am of that.
Just try not to get him killed. Let him get killed.
What the fuck am I gonna do?
I don't know.
I mean, you know, people do die doing stuff solo. Just saying. Don't tighten the belt too much. Yeah, I bet you didn't think you'd be hearing an erotic asphyxiation joke tonight, did you?
So, welcome to D&D, Ashton Campaign. I'm Bungo.
Yeah.
Woo!
Yes.
So, alright, so you guys get, I guess, kind of, well, you separate a little bit. So, I guess, what's the first order of business for Togar?
Get good.
Kind of. first order of business is I'm going to go talk to Tormilla's father.
Okay.
Try to get all that squared away and figure out exactly what's going on. Then I can go and let my parents know.
Alright. Cool. And so, yeah, you head up to what is by now a pretty familiar location. The kind of seat of power in the Thogledar. And standing there in an audience with General Snowhand, who is
Well, let's see. Nobody at home knows that you died, and so I think... Well, let's see. I guess the question is... I don't think Tormilla would have actually told anybody that you were dead, so it's just been a really long trip for her going to get you, is kind of what he's thinking. So, he just, as you make your way in and kind of establish your audience with him, he says, it's good to see you again. Sounds as though you've been keeping busy.
Oh, more than you know. I'll kind of throw a sidelong glance at Tormilla. But I'm here now, and I understand that you had a position that needed to be filled, and you were requesting me.
Indeed. And again, you get a very similar kind of rundown of the situation. Basically culminating in, we need a trade minister, and not only are you involved in the trades, but you are one of the few dwarves of Thogledar that he knows that he can implicitly trust. And so, essentially, the job is yours to turn down.
So, I will accept under a couple conditions.
Exclusive trade with Pundel.
Condition number one is I would like to erase the blight that has been his house. I can't remember the guy's name.
Leadforge.
Leadforge. I would like to erase the blight that is Leadforge's house by taking it over and renovating it so that it is no longer considered an evil place.
Or you could raise it to the ground.
No. No.
Burn it. I could do that for free.
And number two, I would like the ability to allow Bungdo to establish his trade facility somewhere in the city so that he can get his business off the ground like I have before. And he will be another great ally and great importation person to have.
Is black grass illegal in the city?
Condition number, what, 4, 3?
Okay, so let's see. I think the way that he'd be willing to make all of this stuff happen is, like, obviously the acquisition of property is, you know, it's at its core, it's a financial transaction. So I think what he'd be willing to do is, given the fact that this would be a paying position, he'd be willing to basically advance you the Leadforge property.
Okay.
And I think as far as getting Bungdo and his stuff set up, Bungdo would have
him.
To. Yeah, I was gonna. Yeah, it's basically like you're getting him a permit.
Yes.
And you're getting him probably like inroads with any commissions or whatever, you know, like relevant guilds to basically say, all right, he's cool. I mean, I know we're dwarves and we mostly keep to ourselves, but it's more of a social thing, I think, than like, you know, hey, Bungdo gets a warehouse.
Yeah, no, that's all I wanted was I wanted to get Bungdo's foot in the door for trading.
Yeah.
Gnomes are basically cousins anyway. Like, fuck the forest gnomes. We're rock gnomes. We're deep gnomes. Rock gnomes, I think.
But yeah,
but
that,
you
that
know, we work with rocks and stuff too. Practically family.
But yes, I agree to the terms.
Okay. So. And so yeah, you are officially recognized as
trade minister of Thogladar and granted the deed to the location formerly known as Leadforge Manor. And trying to think. I mean, I don't think there's any more like pressing business. I mean, obviously, taking the job means that Togar will have some day-to-day stuff that he does, but we'll obviously kind of hand wave it, and we'll talk more on that later. I mean, I know Taylor has plans.
Yes.
Does he have to stay in Thogladar? Like.
So there's that.
Yes. However, I am going to keep contact. And I guess at this point, I'm going to ask Tormilla to come with me back to the manor so that I can explain to Bungdo and Maya what's going on.
Okay.
So.
Yep.
So, go back in, and I'll say, I'll walk in and yell out, Bungdo, Maya, are you guys still here?
Yes!
did you ever figure out what that key's for?
No, I haven't had time. Did I find out what the key was for?
Make an investigation check.
Ooh!
I want to help him.
Okay.
Oh,
investigation
boy.
Check with advantage.
I'm gonna put up my character sheet here. Ew, spells. That's not what I want. Yeah. Said investigation?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
How does this happen?
So, I think through, you know, deductive reasoning, you think, all right, this was a single solitary key that it probably belonged to the owner of the house. So let's start with his bedroom. You know, it seems like a place where you might keep secret items.
Of immense value.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, maybe you look around for, like, safes hidden behind pictures and you know, sliding bookshelves and all that stuff, but no such luck. And so, you know, you're getting to the
sliding point bookshelf to a sex dungeon.
I mean, you don't know. but yeah, you get to the point of like, okay, let's check under the carpets and stuff. And so, you know, you check under the carpet at like, you know, the entrance to the room that kind of like spans over to the foot of the bed, nothing there. But there is like, there's a carpet that sits squarely beneath the bed. And so you kind of stoop down there, and as you're about to like begin lifting up the bed, I think maybe you like stub your toe on something that's like sitting under the bed. And it is a wooden box that, yeah, it's just sitting there. Under the bed, just barely short enough to like fit underneath, and it does appear to be locked. So, putting two and two together, yeah, you slide the box out and open it up, and yeah, there's some dark shit in there.
Bag of holding.
Okay. Well, it's in your bag of holding, not mine, so I guess I don't care as much.
You don't need to sterilize the party bag of holding.
Nope.
Okay.
So, back to my original question. Bungdo, did you find out what that key was for?
Are you on mute?
Bungdo?
Felipe?
Hello?
There we go.
Hello.
Yeah, no, I was definitely not on mute, but I was also definitely talking.
Right.
Anyways, I said, yep!
Well, what was it?
Bungo just smiles and kicks some dirt shyly.
Well, I have good news. That box and everything inside of it is yours. And
there's nothing inside the box now.
And I'll actually pull out the permit, and I'll say, this is also yours, and I'll hand it to him.
What?
That officially recognizes you as being able to trade with the people of Thal Kladar.
Legally?
Yes. So,
dope.
The bad news is, at least for our group, is I will have to stay here and do some day-to-day activities. So, at least for the time being, my adventuring days are over. However, this gives me plenty of time to be able to make sure that the businesses over in... Shit, where was our business?
Drake's Landing.
Drake's Landing!
Yes. Our businesses over in Drake's Landing are running properly and fruitful, because you are looking at the new trade minister of Thal Kladar.
I give Togar a hug.
So I return the hug.
I say, well, I mean, if you think this is what's best for you, I wish you the best of luck, and I'm sure that we will see each other many times.
Oh, yes. I think, for now at least, I need to help out my people, and I need to help out General Snowhand, and I will also return the favor to you guys by managing the, or at least overseeing some of the business in Drake's Landing, and make sure nothing, you know, nothing goes wrong, but
No idea how to run business, so that's probably for the best.
I hit things.
As you can tell, I don't have my armor, which I will need to remedy. And rather than bore you guys by making you stay while I craft a whole new set of armor, I will hold up shop here and... or hold down the fort here and set up... open up my shop for the armor.
Do you want some bear pelts and your small anvil and jewel armor and thogonite?
Yes, you've got all of that. Yes, by all means.
Yeah.
By all means, anything you guys and consider this house yours as well. This is, you guys can feel free to come anytime you would like and stay. Free of charge, of course. Leave anything that you need. Any armor that needs to be mended, just drop it off. I will have
Bungo
it taken care of.
I'll be right back! And then runs up and puts all of the toys back in the box. And then in the guest room. That's his now.
Alright. Done deal.
Okay.
So,
you guys don't see this, you just see him run off.
Yeah,
that's fine.
Don't even question it. It's Bungo.
I will look to Tormilla, and I'll say, for the sake of not just our own comfort, can I possibly get you to consecrate or at least bless this house and this land so that anything else that's of ill intent is shunned?
Of course, I can, well, it's a big job, and she kind of, like, looks around. It's a pretty big house, like, you know, trade minister house. Dude was ballin', right? so, she says, I will contact the temple, and, I, along with, some other members of the clergy can get it done in the next day or so.
Okay. Yeah, that's fine.
Can I, like, customize a guest room for myself?
Yes.
Sweet.
And actually, and I will kind of look towards Tormilla again. I would also like to look into converting the basement into a little bit of a training facility.
Hmm.
You know, set up some target dummies and stuff like that, so that, you know, we and anybody else coming to visit can make sure we're at battle ready at any time.
That sounds like a good plan.
And I'll just toss her a wink.
Okay.
No, just, yeah.
Not that kind of wink.
Yeah, no, just.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, out of character, I figure we're gonna be here, you know, at least a few days due to the emotionally draining journey.
I mean, that's reasonable. And honestly, this is another one of those times we probably want to take a step back for a second and, like, on the meta level, like, this is probably gonna be more along the lines of extended downtime.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
From a game group perspective, like, this would be the perfect opportunity for, you know, the PCs who are sticking around as part of the group to, you know, figure out, I guess, what they want to have as far as their own lives. And then once we have a new player or two, we can figure out ways to incorporate them, possibly tied to an as yet to be revealed new character from Taylor as well.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I was just gonna say what I'm gonna do with my downtime.
Yeah, just I guess the thing is, this could be more on the scale of like weeks to months,
well,
rather
for
than just days.
The next couple weeks, I'm going to decorate my room and help with the basement training room and probably learn some blacksmithing.
Okay.
If I'm not too annoying.
Yeah. And I would be willing to help out with all of that as well.
Okay.
How big is Bungo's room?
It's pretty big. I mean, you know, you, let's see. I'd say it's, we'll say along the lines of like 15 by 15.
Perfect.
I mean, yeah, I don't have a ton of personal funds, but I'm sure, you know, a lot of it. Oh, no, I do have a ton. I have 40 platinum. That's enough to do whatever the hell I want.
Dude,
I have a mega 40 platinum.
What'd you say, Eric?
I have a mega 40 platinum.
Yeah. No, I didn't see it. I'm like, I only have 211 silver.
One platinum is 10 gold, right?
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah. No, 400 gold is definitely enough to renovate my room.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so was there anything in particular that Bungo wanted to focus on over those couple of weeks?
Yeah, he builds a hot box in the corner of his room. builds like some super comfortable furniture, or gets comfortable furniture.
Okay.
Probably builds it. Bungo's a DIY guy.
All right. Alright, so, yeah, pretty much just, like, house stuff, basically, across the board?
Yep.
Okay. Cool.
Bungo would also like to poke around for a place to sell the, fey black grass. Very, very high value.
Ah, yes. Okay. I mean, you do have a street drug connection in town, if he's still around.
Yeah, that I still haven't delivered his package, so.
This is true.
Haven't been the fuck back to Strassi yet.
I mean, yeah, Yeah, we'll also spend the time, you know, like, actually doing, you know, some of my monk training and stuff.
Okay. Once again, Sadie is concerned, because once again, Pete's butt is in her bed.
Pete, get off her bed!
Well, she needs to use it.
Yeah. I got him off your bed for you.
Okay. She's not even laying in her bed. She just sits on it and stares at Pete.
This is mine.
Be gone, foul beast.
Be gone, peasant. This is my when? Ass spot.
I mean, yeah.
She laid down. Mostly on her bed.
Yes. Okay. So, I don't know. I mean, like, that being the case, is there anything that we wanted to do that is going to happen before that time hop? Because I think the time hop is basically going to be the end of the episode.
I mean, I guess I do want to go see my parents.
Yeah.
I'm just learning things.
Okay. Cool. So then, yeah, we've got this this scene where Togar heads back under the auspices of totally having been alive the whole time and just getting a job offer.
Are we all there?
Well, I actually would have snuck off during while you guys were working on your rooms.
At some point, I would see them too and say hi, but
yeah. I just, for the initial thing, I snuck off.
Yeah, yeah. No, I'm not gonna crash your personal time with your parents.
Bungdo sighs.
Not even knowing that he was snuck off on, but yeah. Okay. So, you sneak off.
Yes.
To your parents' house.
Yes. And I will just walk up to the door, and as is usual, knowing that my mom has it locked up tight, I'm going to pick the locks.
Okay.
So, sleight of hand?
I mean, actually, it is dexterity. Like, that's the thing that I've kind of been not doing right. So, yeah, go ahead and make a dexterity check. A little rusty.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Just break the lock.
I'm just gonna knock on the door.
So yeah, we see this like couple seconds as Togar is like fiddling with the lock, and you just hear like this little like clicking sound, like, oh, did I get it? And try to open it and you realize, oh, I might have snapped something off in there. Alright.
Yeah. I'm just gonna put it back in my pocket and knock.
Okay. Yeah, and so you knock, and after a moment, your mother comes and opens the door, and she says, "Oh, what? I didn't even know you were in town. Well, come in.
All right. Hey, by the way, Mom. I think something's stuck in this lock. You might want to get that fixed before you try to leave the house and lock up. I'll take a look at it later.
Alright. Hold on.
Glossing over how you might know that.
Yeah.
And why you don't have a key to your parents' house.
Yeah, she does not seem to find anything at all suspicious about that statement.
Okay.
Because her little boy is just a perfect little angel.
Yeah.
Bullshit.
My son is not the problem. Obviously, the teacher and all the other kids are the problem.
Okay. Yes.
The little shit.
Okay. So, anyway, you're inside.
Yes. And I'll say, well, how are things here? I have great news, but first, how are things?
Things have been good. Your father's maintaining the business, at least at higher standards than they were before. Moradin, bless him. I think he really needed the help that you gave him last time you were in town. What else? We have beer. We have lots of beer.
Good.
I wouldn't say we're in the black on that just yet, but the word is spreading.
That's good.
Other than that, day to day, living life. I worry about you a lot, though. Out on the road and putting yourself in harm's way.
Well, I will say, you don't have to worry about that, at least for a while now. I'm home to stay for a good bit.
Really?
Yes. I actually had another business venture that popped up that was too good to pass up. Mom, you are now looking at the trade commissioner?
Trade minister.
Minister.
Yeah.
You're looking at one of the new trade ministers of Thoglodar.
Okay. And so at that point, she does like the overexcited like mom squeal where she doesn't actually use words. She just like her hands go up and just runs over and hugs you. and so that happens. Mm-hmm. And she's like, how did this happen?
Well, you met Tormilla, General Snowhand's daughter.
He died and came back to life.
She actually came and found us and told me that she requested that I come back and told me that they really needed me here to help out with things after what happened last time we were here. So I came back and, I now own the manor and I kind of explain to her where it is, and that's going to be where I guess I'm going to be staying for now. Good thing is I'll be able to help out with all of these little side things that I've had you guys doing, and I'll also be able to possibly have a hand at being able to sell some of our beer that we're making a little easier.
Side note out of character, Bungdo could ship that to other places.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, but I'm back for a while.
Well, this is just wonderful. She's like kind of flustered, like not even knowing what to do, and just, all right. Can I make you dinner?
Dinner would be lovely.
Okay. And so we kind of like, fade to this moment of like her rushing back into the kitchen, and then there's like, you and your mom and your dad seated at the dinner table, just like the good old days before all the adventuring.
Yep.
And yeah. Anything else you wanted to do before downtime?
No, that's it. I'm good for that.
Okay.
Fix her door.
Yeah, as Togar leaves, we see him like bust out the thieves' tools again, but this time to fish out the busted piece of one that was in the lock.
Yep.
Okay. Go ahead and make a dex check for me.
All right.
Nat 20.
30-20. Good enough. Okay. You managed to do that. And I guess we will pick things up whenever we have another player, which hopefully should be soon. You know, obviously, Phil, let me know how things go on your end. But yeah, we can kind of, I mean, it'll probably be character dependent too. Like, we'll see who we're bringing in and what would make sense for the situation. But yeah. So it's kind of like, I don't know. I feel like we're sort of soft resetting the campaign, you know?
A little bit. I mean, to be fair,